Well, good afternoon. Good to be with you again. It's Father Bruno here from St. Dominic, presenting personal prayer by Father Thomas Ackland and Father Boniface Hicks, Feast of St. Agatha today. Let's say a prayer and then begin our conversation. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Lord, give us growth in loving faith and greater conviction that in a wonderful way, you want nothing other than us simply to be with you, for you, and in you, glorifying you by our lives. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Virgin Martyr St. Agatha, pray for us. Holy Father St. Dominic, pray for us. Our Lady, Queen of Preachers, pray for us. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. All right, so we have... great. Somebody else has entered in. Hi, we have you on mute and the video off. We're presenting chapter 4, Praying in Loving Faith, from the book Personal Prayer. As has been our practice for the previous weeks, I shall simply comment on some prominent elements from the chapter. And then after about 15 minutes, we will shut down the video recording and have conversation. This week, two things come to mind regarding this chapter, Loving Faith, Praying in Loving Faith. The first is the reminder that the authors stress the incarnational dynamic of Christian prayer. All religions, all people really, we can say, have an aptitude for prayer. But Christians who confess that God became one of us, Christians who by their nature confess the incarnation, our reality takes on a different shape. Our prayer becomes uniquely incarnational. So this week, or in this chapter, the authors give some consideration to the role of feelings and passions. Typically speaking, many of us, myself at least, experience feelings as distracting, unruly, and therefore something that might inhibit prayer. We also might have a picture of prayer in our minds of the quiet person with all operations turned off, lost in unaffected repose. Well, that certainly has something to play in the life of prayer. In fact, the ancient fathers do use what we now say as apathy, apatheia, to refer in a non-pejorative way to that sense of being unaffected by anything other than attachment to God. Now, that being the case, even though there is the call for certain detachment, dispassionate, regard for the things of God, nevertheless, the whole life of prayer, being an entire life, does carry with it this element of feeling and passion, even vicissitude. So one of the things the authors want us to appreciate is that this too is to be brought to prayer, that there is no element of our life that is not to be subjected to the regimen of prayer, to the commitment of relationship with God. The other thing I want to say, just by way of introduction as well, is what faith is. Now, the authors mentioned the importance of loving faith. And in our previous session, we discussed the importance of both faith and love, loving surrender. All right, so these are the two elements. Intellectual and volitional, if you will, having to do with the mind, having to do with decision-making and the heart, if you will. All right. Faith, and loving surrender. Both of these are required to approach God. Faith, why? Well, because irrespective of what I might be feeling or thinking, I need divine supernatural faith to ground me in relationship with God. Faith is a gift fundamentally given to us by baptism. And through baptism, we are literally staked in God. All right. So faith. One other thing about faith I want to say comes from the book, from the letter to the Hebrews, which we've been reading in the daily masses this cycle. It comes from Hebrews 11:1. I believe I mentioned it last week. It bears repeating. But Hebrews 11:1 gives a classical definition for faith. Faith is the substance of what is hoped for. Now, the word substance there is tricky, difficult to define. Other translations will have reality. But faith is the reality, the substance, the very stuff, the very richness of what is hoped for. And it is the evidence or the interior argument, conviction, assurance, even, of things unseen. In other words, even though we walk by faith and not by sight, even though this life is about leading and being led toward God in everlasting friendship, what faith gives us is a kind of real purchase upon that ultimate, that final, that destinating reality, heaven, vision of God, communion. So faith, by its very nature, possessing it, by being baptized Christians who do not actively work against what we are taught to believe, faith already gives us this spiritual reality. Excuse me here while I clean my nose. Excuse me. And this faith is absolutely important for understanding what the authors are talking about, because the kind of loving faith that we are being invited to generate through prayer is this recollection and repose in the fact that by being baptized Christians, we can renew and grow our experience of what is to come. That's a paradox. It's a paradox. That which is to come is something you and I already share by way of faith. And so when our feelings and other thoughts and emotions are destabilizing us, we ought to articulate explicit acts of faith, statements of scripture, statements of doctrine, statements of confidence that return us to the ground, which says what? My life is hidden with Christ in God. I shall set my sights upon the things that are above, not the things that are below, as we hear in Colossians 3. Okay? So those are just two basic perspectives, one emphasizing the incarnational aspect, the other emphasizing faith here. With respect to the chapter, the authors dwell a lot on feelings, what they call feelings. And feelings can be distracting. That is to say, they can pull us away from our goal. And they can also be confusing. That is to say, that they can lead us to think that something is the case when it is not. To put this in common parlance, feelings are subjective, and therefore they have the capacity to undercut our ability to embrace what is true, what is the case, what is the matter at hand, what is objective, if you will. Now, that caution being said, nevertheless, the authors are inviting us to bring the fact of our feelings into our relationship with God, you see? So again, it's similar to a relationship with intimate others. Before we can go about discussing the merit or the implications of my feelings, I need at least to let the other know how I feel or how I have been made to feel. And when I first recognize that that feeling has been appreciated, accepted, felt. Then we can talk about whether or not it's on the right track or on the wrong track, what we can do to work on it. It's a similar thing with God, that we are invited to bring our feelings, the fact of them, into our relationship with God, always grounding, basing, establishing, and rooting our dispositions in faith. In faith. And the faith that they speak of is not just any faith, but a loving faith. The faith that says, I furthermore embrace you, Lord. I choose you. I want to live with you. Again, so this is faith and surrender. Intellect and will. Thinking and choosing. Loving faith, as the authors put it. I want to read this passage from the Catechism, because it might shed some light on what's meant by feelings. The classical term in the tradition, Western philosophical and Catholic Christian tradition, is basically passions. And what the word means is that these are events that we undergo, right? So when I am feeling sad, when I'm feeling angry, when I'm feeling joyful, there's a way in which you and I can say that we are undergoing these as events. And so that's what the root of the word passion there basically indicates. Let me read a couple of passages from the Catechism. This is paragraph number 1764. It's from the section on the part, rather, on morality and discussing the different elements of the human person structure. The passions, the Catechism says, are natural components of the human psyche. They form the passageway and ensure the connection between the life of the senses and the life of the mind. Our Lord calls man's heart the source from which the passions spring. So the passions are, if you will, events that spring forth between our animal aspect and our spiritual aspect, right? So it's not uncommon for us to see, say, a snarling dog and recognize that it's angry in some sense, right? So you and I experience something analogous to that, but it takes on a different character because of the way in which our animality is integrated with our spirituality. And so when we talk about our anger, we're talking about a human passion, something that ought to be directed as much as we can by our spiritual and intellectual knowledge. Here's another statement that's important. 1769. In the Christian life, the Holy Spirit himself accomplishes his work by mobilizing the whole being with all its sorrows, fears, and sadness, as is visible in the Lord's agony and passion. In Christ, human feelings are able to reach their consummation in charity and divine beatitude. So you see, one of the things actually that prayer does is it's kind of a therapy. It's kind of a cleansing, right? Because you and I go about the day and experience any number of things and suffer or undergo any number of emotional events, and feelings transpire. And what we ought to do in prayer is present them to the Lord so he can clarify them, let us know their significance, and if we need, allow him to take them away, allow him to absorb them into himself. Also allow him to redirect them, okay? Couple more things. I know we're on the 15-minute mark. I want to say two more things. One is about St. Ignatius, and another is about the sacrament of the present moment. I spent a lot of time on feelings. The authors here, and they'll mention it elsewhere, refer to St. Ignatius founder of the Society of Jesus, the Jesuits, and his framework of discernment of spirits, discerning between the good spirit and the bad spirit, discerning between consolation and desolation. Now, these two terms, consolation and desolation, are very close to our feeling and emotional life. I don't want to say too much more about it because there's it's important to have Ignatius on Ignatius's own terms. I refer to it only because the authors do, and because it's a prominent theme in modern spiritual tradition. The point is that when we reflect upon our life and notice consolation, we know that God is at work, that the good spirit is at work. The psalmist says, "Let your good spirit guide me, O Lord." Okay. When we sense desolation, and these are things that are we ought to have some kind of guidance with from another, generally speaking. When we sense desolation, this is the enemy. This is the bad, the evil spirit. Guard me from your evil spirit. All right. As I said, I don't want to say more about this, but one easy way to just briefly itemize the two. One, when I'm experiencing consolation, what I am feeling, if you will, is I can do this. And this is God. Now, it doesn't mean that I necessarily am cheerful. I could be repentant over my sins, crying, and yet I know that it's from the Lord. Why? Because I know I can move along in the Christian life and God is convicting me of my sins. That's consolation. All right. So consolation, I would say, is marked by the sense that I can with respect to God. And this is God. This is God. Desolation is marked by the sense that I can't do this. I just can't. And the conviction is that this is me. There's an inward focus. This is probably from the enemy. Okay. I don't want to say more about that. I'm not trained in Ignatian spirituality, and there are plenty of great authors out there who can guide us. But the Benedictines, Acklin, and Hicks mention this, and they will again, so I want to just highlight it for you. Last point, regarding the so-called sacrament of the presence of God. Around the 16th, 17th century, there developed in Christian spirituality a renewed awareness that we ought to abandon ourselves to God in all of the circumstances of our life. That there's a kind of sacramentality to reality as it presents itself to us. Now, it doesn't mean God tells us not to act. Now, that's actually heretical. It's not that we don't have to respond in certain ways, but everything is as God has ordained, and he will give me what I need to act. Authors that emphasize this, certainly The Little Flower, St. Thérèse Lisieux, also the author Jean-Pierre de Caussade, and his well-known little treatise, Abandonment to Divine Providence. This is important, and prayer harnesses this attitude of accepting reality on reality's terms, on God's terms. Why? Because it is embraced in loving faith. And this is why when we spoke a couple of weeks ago about the nature of trust, one element of trust, reliability, God is reliable. The other element we might think about is just acceptance. Jesus Christ, I trust you. Things are as you have allowed them to be, and you will give me the resources to respond as you will. But I make the act of loving faith to say that you are here with me in this. Okay. So that wraps up this presentation, a selective presentation of the chapter on prayer as loving faith, its incarnational shape, where we appreciate our feeling life, are cautious about getting swept away in its subjectivist orientations that might becloud our mind, but nevertheless present them to the Lord, and also accepting not only the way we feel, but the way things are. All right. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Let us pray for all our brothers and sisters who have yet to find God at work and alive in their lives. See you next week, everyone.